فاشرف بي لاشتغالي بالعلم ولا تبغي به ما عشت يا ذا بدلا ويا له من شرف عظيم.
في استحباب تحسين الصوت بالقرآن أجمع العلماء رضي الله عنهم من السلف والخلف من الصحابة والتابعين ومن بعدهم من علماء الأمصار أئمة المسلمين على استحباب تحسين الصوت بالقرآن، وأقوالهم وأفعالهم مشهورة نهاية الشهرة، فنحن مستغنون عن نقل شيء من أفرادها، ودلائل هذا من حديث رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم مستفيضة عند العامة والخاصة، كحديث زينوا القرآن بأصواتكم، وحديث لقد أوتي مزمارا، وحديث ما أذن الله، وحديث لله أشد أذنا، وقد قدمت كلها في الفصل السابق. وقد تقدم في فصل الترتيل حديث عبد الله بن مغفل في ترجيع النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم القراءة، وكحديث سعد بن أبي وقاص وحديث أبي لبابة رضي الله عنهما أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال: من لم يتغن بالقرآن فليس منا، رواهما أبو داود بإسنادين جيدين. وفي إسناد سعد اختلاف لا يضر، قال جمهور العلماء معنى لم يتغن لم يحسن صوته. وحديث البراء بن عازب رضي الله عنه قال: سمعت النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قرأ في العشاء بالتين والزيتون، فما سمعت أحدا أحسن صوتا منه، رواه البخاري ومسلم. قال العلماء رحمهم الله تعالى: فيستحب تحسين الصوت بالقراءة وتزيينها ما لم يخرج عن حد القراءة بالتمطيط، فإن أفرط حتى زاد حرفا أو أخفاه فهو حرام. وأما القراءة بالألحان فقد قال الشافعي رحمه الله تعالى في موضع أكرهها، وقال في موضع لا أكرهها. قال أصحابنا: ليست على قولين، بل فيه تفصيل، فإن أفرط في التمطيد فجاوز الحد فهو الذي كرهه، وإن لم يجاوز فهو الذي لم يكره. وقال أقضى القضاة في كتابه الحاوي: القراءة بالألحان الموضعة للأغاني إن أخرجت لفظ القرآن عن صيغته بإدخال حركات فيه أو إخراج حركات منه أو قصر ممدود أو مد مقصور أو تمطيط يخفى به اللفظ ويلتبس به المعنى فهو حرام، يفسق به القارئ ويأثم به المستمع، لأنه عدل به عن نهج القويم إلى الإعوجاج. والله تعالى يقول: قرآنا عربيا غير ذي عوج. قال: فإن لم يخرجه اللحن عن لفظه وقراءته على ترتيله كان مباحا، لأنه زاد بألحانه في تحسينه. هذا كلام أقضى القضاة. وهذا القسم الأول من القراءة بالألحان المحرمة مصيبة ابتلي به بعض العوام الجهلة والطغام الغشمة الذين يقرؤون على الجنائز وفي بعض المحافل، وهذه بدعة محرمة ظاهرة يأثم كل مستمع لها كما قاله أقضى القضاة، ويأثم كل قادر على إزالتها أو على النهي عنها، إذا لم يفعل ذلك وقد بذلت فيها بعض قدرتي وأرجو من فضل الله الكريم أن يوفق لإزالتها من هو أهل لذلك وأن يجعله في عافية. قال الشافعي في مختصر المزني رحمه الله تعالى ويحسن صوته بأي وجه كان. قال وأحب ما يقرأ حدرا وتحزينا. قال أهل اللغة يقال حدرت القراءة إذا أدرجتها ولم تمططها ويقال فلان يقرأ بالتحزين إذا أرق صوته. وقد روى ابن أبي داود بإسناده عن أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه أنه قرأ إذا الشمس كورت يحزنها شبه الرثاء. وفي سنن أبي داود قيل لابن أبي مليكة أرأيت إذا لم يكن حسن الصوت؟ فقال يحسنه ما استطاع.
Regarding the recommendation of using peace found the voice while reciting.
This chapter, the author, rahimahullah, is going to talk about the concept or the idea of beautifying one's voice, reading the Quran with a beautiful recitation. Naam.
Scholars among the companions and the tabi'is, as well as those who came after them from among the scholars of different countries and cities, and the leaders of the Muslims have all agreed that it is recommended to beautify one's voice when reciting the Quran.
The author here says, أجمع العلماء. أجمع means what? There's a consensus, a unanimous consensus of the ulama radiallahu anhu, may Allah be pleased with all of them, from the salaf and the latecomers, which is the khalaf, the sahabas, the tabi'een, and those who came after them, from the ulama al-amsar, from the scholars of the Muslim land, على استحباب تحسين الصوت بالقرآن, to beautify one's voice in reciting the Quran. So they are all by consent, the ulama, that one has to beautify or should beautify his voice with the Qur'an.
The sayings and actions that reflect this are so well known that we hardly need mention any of them in particular. Additionally,
so the author says, وَأَقْوَالُهُمْ وَأَفْعَالُهُمْ, the speeches of the sahabas and the tabi'een and the ulama and their actions in this particular issue, which is beautifying the voice, it's so well known and it's so famous that he won't even try to bring evidences for it. He won't even try to bring forward. Naam.
Additionally, proofs regarding this issue from the statements of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam are also well known, both to the common folk and to the people of knowledge. Such proof has already been mentioned that includes statements such as, beautify the Quran with your voices. He has been endowed with a mizmar. Allah listens to nothing more closely. And the hadith, Allah listens more closely.
All of these hadith which we already mentioned, which is Zayyinul Qur'ana bi aswatikum, beautify your voices when reciting the Qur'an. Hadith, laqad utiya mizmaran, he has been given the flute and the voices of Nabiullah Dawood. Ma adhina Allahu, ay ma asma Allahu. Allah is more hearing of the voice of one's the beautified voice. All of those narrations which he has mentioned in the previous section is an evidence, okay, to show the permissibility and rather the fact that it's recommended to beautify your voice when reading the Qur'an. Naam.
Regarding the virtue of tartil, we have already mentioned the hadith of Abdullah ibn Mughaffal narrated explaining that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would repeat verses during his recitation. Likewise, Sa'ad ibn Abi Waqqas and Abu Lubaba's
name is Rifa'a ibn Abdul Mundir. Rifa'a ibn Abdul Mundir is his name, hey?
May Allah be pleased with them both. Reported a hadith where the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, whoever does not recite the Holy Quran with a beautiful voice is not of us. Abu Dawood narrated these hadith, each with a good chain of narration. There is a slight disagreement regarding the chain of narration in the hadith of Sa'ad that is of no real harm.
So here the author, rahimahullah, he mentions that the Prophet ﷺ, he said, مَن لَمْ يَتَغَنَّ بِالْقُرْآنِ, anyone who doesn't beautify his voice with the Quran, فليس منا, he's not from us. And this hadith, Abu Dawood narrated it with two chains that are authentic. Even that though, there is a difference regarding Sa'ad's narration. Na'am.
Al-Bara, may Allah be pleased with him, narrated, I heard the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam reciting Surah T during the Isha prayer, and I do not know anyone who had a more beautiful voice than him.
Al-Bara ibn Azib radiallahu anhu, he said, I heard the Prophet ﷺ recite in Isha. The Prophet, what did he recite in Isha? He recited At-Tin wa Zaytun wa Tur Sinin. And he said, فَمَا سَمِعْتُ, I never heard أَحَدًا, anyone أَحْسَنَ صَوْتًا مِنْهُ, more beautiful voice than him. His voice was the best, عليه الصلاة والسلام. رواه البخاري ومسلم. Bukhari and Muslim narrated, hey?
The scholars, may Allah have mercy on them all, conclude that it is recommended to beautify one's voice when reciting the Qur'an, as long as that does not go beyond limits and lead to the addition of letters or leaving out of other letters, as in such cases it would be prohibited.
He says, قال العلماء رحمهم الله, the scholars, they said, فيستحب تحسين الصوت, it is recommended that a person beautifies his voice. بالقراءة with recitation, وتزيينها, and to make it beautiful. ما لم يخرج عن حد القراءة بالتمطيط, but as long as it doesn't leave and it doesn't go outside the restricted amount, meaning you don't add any letters to the Quran or you do not reduce a letter from it, because if that happens, فهو حرام. And sometimes what you find is that beautifying your voice, sometimes you find that you may fall into, because you're trying to follow a particular method, a rhyme, or a particular way that you're reading, that you add a letter, or you probably may even take a letter off. Na'am. So this sometimes it goes extreme in some people, and it's not a normal thing that people should do, but this is incorrect. Na'am.
There are two different reports from Imam Shafi'i regarding the recitation of the Qur'an in a melodic manner. May Allah have mercy on him. In the first, he reported and indicated that he disliked this practice. And in the second, he didn't.
So what, the recitation of what?
The recitation of Qur'an in a melodic manner.
Uh-huh. So if a person reads the Qur'an in a musical rhythm, like he reads it bi-alhan. Lahan here means it's in a musical rhythm. فَقَدْ قَالَ شَافِعِيُّ رَحِمَهُ اللَّهِ. Imam Shafi'i said, أَكْرَهُهَا, I dislike this. وَقَالَ فِي مَوْضِعِ لَا أَكْرَهُهَا. And another place he said, I don't dislike it. Bi-alhan actually means melody. You know these melodies that people do? This, huh? And maqamat is even, that's worse. No, it's not this. That's it.
Mm-hmm. Our companions have stated that these are not two conflicting opinions.
So some scholars, the one who narrated from him that he said la akrahuha, la ba'sa biha, is Imam al-Muzani. And Imam al-Muzani transmitted from Shafi'i that he said la ba'sa biha. He said that. Lakin al-Rabi' ibn Sulaiman al-Muradi, in Kitab al-Umm, he transmitted that Shafi'i said, I dislike it. I don't see it to be permissible. Now.
Our companions have stated that these are not two conflicting opinions.
So the Shafi'i scholars, they said that the statement that Muzani transmitted from him and the statement that Rabi' ibn Sulaiman al-Muradi transmitted from him are not two conflating, so they're not two contradicting opinions. That it's not Shafi'i's statements are contradicting each other. Rather, it needs an explanation. Now.
For instance, if the reciter goes to extremes in his recitation so that he mispronounces the words, then it is disliked. If, however, he avoids this and is able to pronounce properly, then this is not disliked.
So Shafi'i rahimahullah is talking about the way and the method that the person recites. If the person's recitation has actually gone beyond the amount, I mean, it's gone out of the limits that were set for them, then this is something he doesn't like. But if it's within the boundaries, then it is what? It is permissible. So that's what Shafi'i's two statements are referring to. Na'am?
In the book Al-Hawi,
Al-Hawi,
Al-Mawafi,
The Hawi al Kabir, that's what he says.
Al Muwaddi, the prominent and distinguished judge, stated that if the melodic recitation of the Quran distorts its words from their original pronunciations by either adding vowels or taking vowels out, or by shortening what should be prolonged, or by prolonging that which should be made short, or distorts the meaning, then it is absolutely not permissible. Both the reciter and listener will have sinned for participating in such a practice, with the reciter bearing a greater sin.
You see, so if it's reaching a point where the person is actually inserting letters in there, or he's actually taking out letters, or the beautification of your voice is actually making you read extra mudud, so you're just pulling it extra because you feel like it's beautiful that way, okay? Or you're shortening the mudud, the med, you're shortening it when you should be saying a bit longer, you're saying a bit shorter because of the voice, then of course this is all haram. And he says, يَفْسُقُ بِهِ الْقَارِ. The qari, the reciter, will be a fasiq for doing that. وَيَأْثَمُ بِهِ. And he become a sinner for doing so. The reason is because لِأَنَّهُ عَدِلَ عَنْ نَهْجِ الْقَوِيمِ إِلَى الْإِعْوِجَاجِ. You've turned away from the correct way of reading the Qur'an, and you've resorted to reading in a deformed, incorrect manner. And Allah says in the Qur'an, قُرْآنًا عَرَبِيًّا, that the Qur'an is in the Arabic language, غَيْرَ الْإِعْوَجِ. It has no crookedness to it. So the way you're reading it is crooked. That's not the Arabic, and that's not the Qur'an, the way it came down.
Al-Bawardi continues, if the melody does not change the correct wording, recitation, or tartil, then it is permissible, as the melodic recitation of the Qur'an increases its beauty.
So if the person's recitation is not, the beautification of your voice, is not taking out any of that, or is not doing all of those mistakes, you're not doing that, then it's permissible, because what it does is that it beautifies your voice. And the Kitab al-Hawi al-Kabir is written by al-Mawardi rahimahullah, who is a Shafi'i. Naam.
The first form of melodic recitation we've described, therefore, is sinful. Indeed, it is a wrongdoing which some among the ignorant masses and other rabble have fallen into.
So here, the first type of the melody recitation that you see that people read, that's haram. You find the Egyptians read that like that. The ones that they go for so long. You see? You find Abdul Basl Abdussamad does that sometimes. There's another one called Tablawi, he does that as well. Are you with me? They go off extreme. Look, wrong, it's incorrect. And sometimes you find other reciters reading like that. You see, they're all not nice for you to actually. لذلك, generally speaking, the people whose Quran you should listen to, whose Quran is actually well done, is the recitation of Mahmud Khalil al-Husari. Sheikh Mahmud Khalil al-Husari's recitation is very, very solid. And Muhammad Sadiq al-Manshawi is good as well, but there's only types of his ones that are good. His recitation is amazing. It's even nice the way he reads Manshawi. If you like, you'd enjoy it as well. Abdul Basr's recitation is good when he reads normally. When he reads normally, it's good. But he has these mujawwad, he calls it, where it's really not mujawwad, but it is muharraf, tahrif of some of the verses, subhanAllah, to be honest. The way it's being read is incorrect. It's not right. Those type of recitations are a musibah, so a calamity that has befallen on the Muslims. Yeah?
Such are those who recite in funerals and other ceremonies, and this recitation is clearly a prohibited innovation.
So he believes. And now he believes there's innovation. Bid'ah, muharrama, rahimahullah. From these things he adds to bid'ah. When in reality beautifying your voice is then what? What does it have? It has a textual evidence that originally permits it, right? But he still believes that because it's being done in a particular way that's wrong, that it's not allowed.
Rendering even those listening to it as sinners, as has been stated by the most eminent of judges, Al-Mawardi. Additionally, anyone able to eradicate or prevent such wrongdoing from occurring and does not do so is also regarded as sinning.
These statements, أقضى الغضاتي, and stuff like that, It's good to avoid it. The greatest of jurists, like أقضى القضاة. I mean, that's, these are terms that has come, these names, Taqiyuddin, Shihabuddin, Nasiruddin, all of these terms, they've been coined by foreigners. The Arabs never used to have those names. Are you with me? This is not something that was known at the time of the Sahabas nor the Tabi'een. It's something that was lately introduced after that. That somebody's name is called Taqiyuddin, Shihabuddin, you know, and etc. Names like that. Aqdal Qudat. Aqdal Qudat. You know what Aqdal Qudat means? The judges of all judges. Who's that? Who's the judges of all judges? Allah. Allah. Things like that are mubalagha, shadeed. It's unnecessary. So one should abstain from those type of terms.
Additionally, anyone able to eradicate or prevent such wrongdoing from occurring and does not do so is also regarded as sinning. While I have made some efforts in this regard, I ask that Allah guide those capable of eradicating such practices to accomplishing this task, and I ask that He give them strength.
Look at Nawawi rahimahullah ta'ala. He's saying here, وَقَدْ بَدَلْتُ فِيهَا بَعْضَ قُدْرَتِهِ. Even I, Nawawi, tried my best to stop many people from doing this type of recitation. I've stopped them from it. And I've stopped them from this innovation. وَأَرْجُ مِنْ فَضْلِ اللَّهِ. And I hope from Allah's virtue, الْكَرِيمِ أَنْ يُوَفِّقَ لِإِزَالَتِهَا. He gives the ability for those who are in charge and authority to get to stop this. وَيَجْعَلَهُ فِي عَافِيَةٍ. And that He makes us healthy from this. Na'am.
In the book Mukhtasar al-Muzni, Imam Shafi'i states, he, the reciter, should strive to beautify his voice in whatever way he can. And I see it as preferable that he recites in a voice that is both flowing without elongating the vowels and stops.
So he should do it hadran wa tahzeenan. That the person reads it, the voice flows, and he's not also causing any harm to the letters and the words to the, of the Qur'an.
Ibn Abi Dawood narrated that his chain of narration, that Abu Huraira, may Allah be pleased with him, recite Surah Shams and softened his voice as though he were lamenting. In the Sunan of Abi Dawood, it is narrated that Ibn Abi Ulayka was asked, what if he, the reciter, does not have a beautiful voice? He replied, he should beautify it to the best of his ability.
Some people don't have nice voices, they don't. They don't have nice voices. Okay? But they should try their best. Do what you can. Sahab Bakar, you should do what Allah gave you. Work with what you have. Push yourself to the best. Even then you shouldn't say to yourself that since my recitation is not of that value, the person should. أَرَأَيْتَ إِذَا لَمْ يَكُنْ حَسَنَ الصَّوْتِ فَقَالَ يُحَسِّنُهُ مَاسْتَطَاعَ. That the person should beautify their voice as much as they can. Hafiz ibn Hajar mentions this in his Fathul Bari, Ibn Abi Dawood. And Imam ibn Abi Dawood, he considered this to be Hassan. And Abi Dawood, as you know, if he narrates a hadith in his Sunan, and he does not, in any way, form or shape, he doesn't grade it by criticizing it, nor does he say anything after, he just becomes quiet. فَسُكُوتُ Abu Dawood. Abu Dawood's silence regarding a hadith in his Sunan is normally and generally taken as though he considers it to be authentic. And Hafiz ibn Hajar did that. He authenticated it based on that. If you go to his Fathul Bari, the 9th volume. فصل في استحباب طلب القراءة الطيبة من حسن الصوت. اعلم أن جماعة من السلف كانوا يطلبون من أصحاب القراءة بالأصوات الطيبة أن يقرأوا لهم وهم يستمعون. وهذا متفق على استحبابه وهو عادة الأخيار والمتعبدين وعبادة الله الصالحين وهو عادة الأخيار والمتعبدين وعباد الله الصالحين وهو سنة ثابتة عن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. فقد صح عن عبد الله بن مسعود رضي الله عنه قال قال لي رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم اقرأ علي القرآن فقلت يا رسول الله أقرأ عليك وقد أنزل فقلت يا رسول الله أقرأ عليك وعليك أنزل قال إني أحب أن أسمعه من غيري فقرأت عليه سورة النساء حتى جئت إلى هذه الآية فكيف إذا جئنا من كل أمة بشهيد وجئنا بك على هؤلاء شهيدا قال حسبك الآن فالتفت إليه فإذا عيناه تذرفان رواه البخاري ومسلم وروى الدارمي وغيره بإسنادهم عن عمر بن الخطاب رضي الله عنه أنه كان يقول لأبي موسى الأشعري رضي الله عنه ذكرنا ربنا فيقرأ عنده والآثار في هذا كثيرة معروفة وقد مات جماعة من الصالحين بسبب قراءة من سالوه القراءة والله تعالى أعلم وقد استحب بعض العلماء أن يستفتح مجلس حديث رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم ويختم بقراءة قارئ حسن الصوت ما تيسر من القرآن ثم إنه ينبغي للقارئ في هذه المواطن أن يقرأ ما يليق بالمجلس ويناسبه وأن تكون قراءته من آيات الخوف والرجاء والمواعظ والتزهيد في الدنيا والترغيب في الآخرة والتأهب لها وقصر الأمل ومكارم الأخلاق فصل في مراعاة المعنى في ابتداء القراءة ووقفها ينبغي للقارئ إذا ابتدأ من وسط السورة أو وقف على غير آخرها أن يبتدئ من أول الكلام المرتبط بعضه ببعض وأن يقف على انتهاء الكلام المرتبط ولا يتقيد بالأعشار والأجزاء فإنها قد تكون في وسط الكلام المرتبط كالجزء الذي في قوله تعالى والمحسنات من النساء وفي قوله تعالى وما أبرئ نفسي وفي قوله تعالى فما كان جواب قومه وفي قوله تعالى ومن يقنت منكن لله ورسوله وفي قوله تعالى وما أنزلنا على قومه من بعده من جند من السماء وفي قوله تعالى إليه يرد علم الساعة وفي قوله تعالى وبدا لهم سيئات ما عملوا وفي قوله تعالى قال فما خطبكم أيها المرسلون وكذلك الأحزاب كقوله تعالى واذكروا الله في أيام معدودات وقوله تعالى قل أأنبئكم بخير من ذلكم فكل هذا وشبهه ينبغي ألا يبتدأ به ولا يوقف عليه فإنه متعلق بما قبله ولا تغترن بكثرة الفاعلين له من القراء من القراء الذين لا يراعون هذه الآداب ولا يفكرون في هذه المعاني. وامتثل ما رواه الحاكم أبو عبد الله بإسناده عن السيد الجليل الفضيل بن عياض رضي الله عنه قال: لا تستوحش طرق الهدى لقلة أهلها، ولا تغترن بكثرة الهالكين. ولهذا معنى قال العلماء: قراءة سورة قصيرة بكمالها أفضل من قراءة بعض سورة طويلة بقدر القصير، أفضل من قراءة سورة طويلة بقدر القصيرة، فإنه قد يخفى الارتباط على بعض الناس في بعض الأحوال. وقد روى ابن أبي داود بإسناده عن عبد الله بن أبي الهذيل التابعي المعروف رضي الله عنه قال: كانوا يكرهون أن يقرأوا بعض الآية ويتركوا بعضها. فصل في أحوال تكره فيها القراءة. اعلم أن قراءة القرآن محبوبة على الإطلاق إلا في أحوال مخصوصة جاء الشرع بالنهي عن القراءة فيها، وأنا أذكر ما حضرني الآن منها مختصرا بحذف الأدلة فإنها مشهورة. فتكره القراءة في حال الركوع والسجود والتشهد وغيرها من أحوال الصلاة سوى القيام، وتكره قراءة ما زاد على الفاتحة للمأموم في الصلاة الجارية إذا سمع قراءة الإمام، وتكره حال القعود على الخلاء وفي حال النعاس، وكذلك إذا استعجم عليه القرآن وكذا حالة الخطبة لمن يسمعها، ولا تكره لمن لا يسمعها بل تستحب، هذا هو المختار الصحيح. وجاء عن طاووس كراهتها وعن إبراهيم النخعي عدم الكراهة، فيجوز أن يجمع بين كلاميهما بما قلنا كما ذكره أصحابنا. ولا تكره القراءة في الطواف، هذا مذهبنا وبه قال أكثر العلماء، وحكاه ابن المنذر عن عطاء ومجاهد وابن المبارك وأبي ثور وأصحاب الرأي، وحكي عن الحسن البصري وعروة بن الزبير ومالك كراهة القراءة في الطواف، والصحيح الأول. وقد تقدم بيان الاختلاف في القراءة في الحمام وفي الطريق وفي من في فمه نجس.